God, people could have called me so many names. Scum, dirty, tramp, you know, list is endless, really.
For me, the worst thing is being called a bad mother.
You're not fit for father.
That I love cannabis more than my children. If I didn't, I'd have quit long ago.
That I'm a bad mum. That I'm a bad daughter.
And I'm just a druggie. I'll never amount to anything.
If you carry on like this, you're going to lose everything. And I did.
I'd lost the right to care for my family.
I think it was the worst thing was what I told myself. That it was just, you know, not worthy of anything or anyone.
And it was noticing all the pain that it causes everybody else through my addiction.
My daughter wrote a letter into Deep to say that she was, that I'd gone from a hero to zero, that she was ashamed of me, she wished I was dead, and I was no longer a role model. I wasn't the father that I used to be. She said that father died a long, long time ago.
The last time I had a drink, my daughter said to me, she says, "Mum, you know I love you, don't you?" I said, "Yes, love, I do." She said, "For the first time ever, Mum," she says, "that little bit of hate," she says, "that is growing." She says, "I don't want to hate you, Mum. Please stop drinking."
Last year, 2 years, has just been absolutely horrendous. Pain that I just couldn't even imagine was possible. I always used to say, you know what I mean, as long as I've got my missus and my kids, and I'll never hit rock bottom. And I'd given up hope on ever being able to stop. But I did lose my kids. And it absolutely broke me.
I think I've lost everything quite several times. I've got a daughter that's 14 months old now. When she was 8 weeks old, I fell with her, pissed up, fractured her skull and lost her. But even that wasn't enough. I put myself into the services, did ramp, came here, and then I relapsed on Deep. And I was in the kitchen, I was in a bad way. Normally when you relapse, you get kicked off completely. The pain was enough. I'd had enough. I couldn't do it anymore. I was on my knees, sobbing, and just said to him, "Help, I can't do it."
I got myself into a situation where I was isolating a lot. I'd cut everybody out of my life. I wouldn't answer the phone, I wouldn't answer texts. I just tried to avoid people as much as I could. My family started to notice all the changes in me, and they were trying very hard to get me to do something about it. I was just in complete denial, and but no, everything's okay, I'm fine. I know what I'm doing. And the truth of the matter was, I had no clue what I was doing. You know, I was just ruining my life. I'd lost everything that I'd worked so hard for. I'd been self-employed for 48 years. I had 2 businesses. I was doing really well. A nice home. And it all just went up my nose.
There was days would go by and I wouldn't remember them. I'd be in blackout a lot of times. And it was just really frightening. And I knew that I just couldn't go on like that. I knew I felt ill. I didn't know what I was doing half the time. I was completely isolated. So it was over Christmas and I spent Christmas by myself. Didn't even know one day from the next. And it just got to a point where it just had to stop.
Lonely and isolated. I was full of fear, more fear than anything. Because I knew that I was gonna end up dead.
It was just a constant fear. I was watching everything sort of disintegrate in front of me. I'd lost my daughters, especially my youngest daughter. I had no contact with her whatsoever. I lost my partner. I was literally scared of killing myself. I had suicidal thoughts, and everything around me was disappearing.
having bad mental health, for me, you know, losing the plot, hearing voices in a hostel, a family-owned hostel in Cheetah Mill. I was just alone in there. It was, you know, scared to even go out the door. I just had enough by then. It was just like I need help.
I had a feeling of self-hatred, self-loathing. I didn't like myself. I didn't know where I was going, had no direction in life. I'd harmed myself. I really didn't know where to go anymore.
Anger. I felt like I was angry. Anxiety, definitely. And fear. I couldn't imagine life without alcohol.
I think I was just tired. Things started to fall apart around me. And it was just getting harder and harder to cope. What made it worse was because everything was built on a lie.
And I'd been sober for nearly 13 years. And one day, I just decided I'm going to have a drink. And I did. And ended up in Leighton Hospital. I shouldn't be alive today. So up until nearly 3 months ago, when I first came onto Deep, I thought I'm going to have to give this a real shot, because if I don't, I'm going to die. If I carry on drinking, I'm going to die. And it's been the hardest thing I've ever had to do, the most worthwhile thing I've done in my life.
It was getting to positions where I didn't know. I was blacking out from the alcohol abuse because it was that much alcohol going in my system. And obviously I got liver damage through doctor's blood tests. And then that's when I knew that I can't do it anymore, I've got to get help.
Well, mainly my ex-wife stopped me seeing me two youngest children, 11 months ago now. So it got worse before better, and after a few months it just brought to my attention that I was never going to get to see my children the way I was going, so it sort of prompted me to get into recovery and clean my acts up to get my children back in my life.
Deep, to me, is something I'll cherish. It's very important, what it gave me. And it's brought a contentment in my life that I didn't have for a very, very long time. It's something that's given me hope again. It's given me an understanding of myself. It's given me understanding of other people.
One of the biggest things, really, is noticing things that you don't really see in yourself. You look at your positives and negatives and things like that. People pick out things, you know. I think it's good that people notice it and tell you, because you don't notice these things yourself.
I had a lot of personal issues going on. Like, my brother died about 4 or 5 years ago, at the age of 51. And that was followed very quickly by my best friend. She committed suicide in my flat, and I found her that morning. And that's haunted me ever since. The outcome of that was I ended up selling my shop and moving out because I couldn't take it anymore. I just gave up the will to work. I basically gave up the will to live. Being able to talk about it in the group and the help and the encouragement, and the way you could trust people and know that whatever you said stayed in the room. I felt a lot of comfort in being able to open up about what was actually going on in my head, what was actually wrong with me.
It's hard work, it's emotional, it could be painful, it could be funny. It's kind of every emotion, it takes you through every emotion, but it does what it needs to do.
Deep's difficult, really, really difficult. You have to go to places where you've never been before and explore your life as a whole, and just the chaos that came with it. Me personally, I loved Deep, and I took a lot from it. And what I've been taught in that room, I'm using it now in my recovery.
I thought the drugs were a problem. I described it as like the chicken and the egg. What came first? Well, if you'd have asked me, it would have been all the drugs, and then the drugs caused me to like behave in a certain way. But my behaviours came first. I found out in Deep Mouth it was my behaviours. From a child, I've always acted aggressively, manipulatively, and just like all behaviours that I took into adulthood, it opened my eyes to the fact that, Tommy, you are this way, you know, but you're able to control them behaviours, so it was eye-opening.
I've got a lot deep. I'm glad I've done it. You know, I did have cognitive counselling on a one-to-one. But I think, you know, it's given me that confidence this time round to sit in a group setting and talk openly and honestly about, you know, how I feel, you know, why, what I suffered as a child, why, what led me to using in the first place and continue to for 30 years. You know, never being loved as a child, sexual abuse, abandonment, you know, covers a lot really with me. So, and I've spoke about it this time. So it's helped me massively.
Finding out stuff, how wrong my thinking, attitudes and behaviours were. I'm a lot more aware of when I'm starting to go down those paths, and I can put a stop to it almost immediately.
It has helped me in ways that I never even thought I needed, let alone thought were possible. The support and patience from my counsellor, from all the people that have been around me have been amazing to me.
I know probably everyone says it's been a lifesaver, but for me it has been a matter of life and death. Obviously we've not seen my children. First Christmas it got to a point where I've become very suicidal and set in my hope, so it's really helped turn my life around. It's just been a godsend, you know, great bunch of people, counsellors and that have been really supportive, and don't think I'd be here today without them, so.
Saved my life. Simple as that.
Wow, it's basically saved my life. It's been a complete life. It's deep as, it's not just about putting the drink down. For me, deep as just, it's changed me as a person. It's liberated me in a way. It's made me open up, but it's getting that stuff out there, and you find that once you get all these emotions out and you speak about them and you have feedback from your peers and you talk, it's just really freeing.
Being more honest with myself as well, being honest with people around me, because I wasn't honest before I did deep, and it's really helped me look at kind of personal stuff in my life I didn't want to look at.
It was finally acceptance was the most significant part for me. When I accepted I had a problem, when I accepted I needed help, once that acceptance came to me, things started to get easier.
Well, I'd say, like I said before, that letter from my mum, having to recognise and look at all the pain that I've caused and the harm I've caused other people through my addiction that I didn't really notice.
Feedback off the rest of the group, it was like, it wasn't always something like you wanted to hear, but at the end of the day, when you walked away and you thought about it, you thought, they're right, they're spot on. They weren't saying it to be nasty, they were just saying it to be helpful. And I think where they got a grasp of that and started to realise that, you know, these people are here to try and help me with my recovery. They're not having a pop at me because of my recovery. And sort of from then, everything just seemed to slot into place.
So I had to do a piece of work around the pain that I caused other people and the ways I'd manipulated people and things like that. And it came out completely different. It came out about me hurting my kids. That way it kind of came out. I think that was probably the most significant point. And realising that the pain I've been through is all right. I'm all right with it. It's happened, I can't escape it. But it's not going to define my future.
When I done my life story, I felt a great weight lifted off my shoulders, though. Even though it was hard and it was emotional, to see where the drinking came from, to see how bad my relationships were, my resentments, especially towards my family. I seen where it started and I could forgive myself. I could move forward then.
I was asked to write about my violent behaviour, especially towards ex-partners, aggressive behaviour. I was asked to pinpoint each and every one. It was the most difficult thing I've ever had to do, was get honest with my pen to paper.
Like to me, you know, to me mum, and you know, to let that resentment and forgive me mum really. I've done one to my dad as well. I've let that resentment go as well.
Particularly two what I class as massive issues to me. One day I just let it all out. And actually within, I think it was about 2 hours of walking out this door after that session, wow, it was like I'd had the weight of the world lifted off my shoulders. They actually aren't issues at all. But yet I'd lived with one of them for 40 years.
The realisation that it was all my fault, I spent too long blaming other people and doing all the letters and the work, you know, just come to realise that it was all my own fault. I'm only here because of my own choices, which I wasn't seeing at the time, so just having my eyes opened, really.
It slows you down a little bit when you're sitting and you're thinking, you're writing, and it really has made me think a lot about a lot of things from the past that I'd never even considered were important or meant anything. It's just being with like-minded people, being with other addicts and discussing things and finding things out about yourself that you never really thought about.
It's also the connection with the people in there, the other peers, the friends that I've got now that would have never been possible.
The friends that I've made, my peers, for the encouragement that they've given me that I can do this. I can be the person I want to be, which is a strong person, you know. And it's not the end once I live deep. It's not the end. I will keep in contact and my recovery will continue once I leave deep, but it's given me the best foundation I could have wished for.
Doing my life story, that really affected me. I kind of missed a lot out of my life story, so I've had to do more work where it involved how it affected my children. I suppose that's been a big, significant part of it, doing that bit.
Letters to my mum and dad, especially my mum, because we were in a codependent relationship and I had a lot of resentments towards her. And over the time on deep, I started to build up a positive relationship with her through talking about it. And now I understand that they've got their own life to lead. So we're building positive relationships. That's a massive, massive part of work that I've done in deep.
And listening to other people's letters that they've done. It's not even that you have to do the letters yourself, you know. There was a guy on there did a letter about regrets. And I always used to say, you know, I haven't got any regrets. I don't do regrets. They're not worth anything. And that letter just absolutely smashed me. Do you know what I mean? I was blubbering in seconds.
I've stopped being pleasing to other people because they want something and I want to please them. I think I've stopped being selfish as well and thinking more what other people are thinking and how they are, and trying to be more thoughtful of them before I say or do things.
It's a connect with people, you know, pick up the phone and talk about what's going on for you, really. I've never done that in the past. I get purpose in life, do something with my life, I help others, You know, that's what it's about, isn't it? I think helping others out there who's still, you know, suffering. That's what I'm going to do.
I guess I've stopped the way I used to be a lot. I try to be as honest as I can now, using my mouth in the right way to say how I feel and be open and honest. And yeah, just taking on suggestion. Involved with fellowships now, both AA and NA.
Well, the benefits to me are immense. I feel a lot healthier than I was. I'm enjoying life a lot more. I'm not isolated anymore. I'm connecting with people. My family started to come round and come back. I'm starting to spend a lot more time with my grandchildren, watching football and various other things together. I have a daily contact with my daughter again. If you'd have asked me 3 months ago or something like that, I wouldn't have thought it was even possible. My life is just 360 degrees turned around. And it's all down to Deep.
Never give up. Just to never give up. Just keep working. Miracles happen. They might only be small ones. And, you know, it takes time. And they're only little ones. But by God, do I appreciate them. And it works.
Well, I'm going back to Liverpool over the weekend to visit my family for the first time overnight since I've been here, which should never have happened. I can support people now. I can support them rather than just support me. And I'm actually doing voluntary work in a charity shop. So I'm giving back to the community that way and giving back to society and not wanting anything in return.
I got good comments when I finished the life story and read the life story out. I got good comments. But I noticed while reading that I'd minimalised a lot of the harm that I'd caused to others. I actually had to pull myself back and say, hang on a minute. So I'm not happy with it. And get honest about it. At the time when I wrote it, to the time when I read it out, was about a period of about 5 weeks. Actually grew in them 5 weeks to be able to get honest and say, hang on a minute, I wasn't as honest as I could be. So it's definitely a life story.
To let go of the pain and hurt that's been with me my whole life, really. And just to get a clear understanding I've got now and what the hurt I've caused other people in my addiction. It's not just all about me today. It's about other people, you know. And to, you know, what hope in me out today that I don't have to use again. You know, we get these feelings I don't have to pick up. I can sort of deal with them now.
Letter to my ex-wife. I spent some 10 years blaming her for everything that was wrong in my life. Stopped seeing my kids and I hated her for it. But then I come to realise it wasn't her I hated, it was myself for the way I'd been through it all. And it was just easier to blame someone else. So. Again, I think that most significant is the realisation of it all.
My life story. Because writing it down was liberating, but reading it out in group was even more so. And the feedback I got from one man and my peers, you know, it's just give me a new freedom, that all that I have carried around with me for all these years, all the hurt and the pain, now is in a place where it should be, which is in the past, and I can move forward with my life.
I had all these feelings inside of me that of love and you know, being able to love my daughters and being able to look after them. I had these thoughts and visions that I could be that person, but no matter how hard I tried, I just couldn't be that person. Today, I know for a fact that I can be. So today, I can be a dad.
I'd like to thank Reach Out and Recover for giving me a safe place to do my recovery.
My key workers, Robert, Tracy, Yvonne.
I'd just like to thank David, who reached out to me and You know, showed me that I could move my life forward. So thank you, David.
My friend Jackie, who has been through the thick and thin of it.
Lizzie and Lee from Ramp.
And you know, peers as well, and friends that I've made around Macclesfield, especially, you know, because I couldn't have done this without yous.
Well, I'd like to thank my daughter Beverly and my grandkids, and Paul, my son, and June, my ex-partner, for the support and the kindness and the help that they've shown. I couldn't have done this without you, and I thank you very much, and I love you all very much.
To Crystal and Sophie, you know, I apologise for all the rubbish I've put you through the last few years, and I hope I can be the father you deserve. So, and grandfather, obviously.
Yeah, I want to thank my brother and his wife, because they've got my daughter, and for looking after her, for doing what they've done for me.
I'd like to thank my family, you know, my brother, for being there for me, and all the way through these last 2 years especially.
Mum and Dad, who unfortunately can't be here today.
First of all, I just really want to thank my dad. So Dad, thank you so much.
Thank you to Aidan, Paul and Lewis for giving me another chance to be a mum today.
I'd like to thank my son and daughter for being my son and daughter.
My mum, for all the continuing support she's ever shown me.
And my partner, who despite everything, has stuck by me for 25 years.
And I'd like to thank my dad, my dad's wife, Trish, and my sisters and my brothers for all the support that they've given me on my journey so far. Thank you.
But most of all, my daughter, who without her bravery and courage, I wouldn't be here today.
I want to say a special thank you to my daughter Chelsea, my son Thomas, and my auntie Lynn for always being there for me and for supporting me and never giving up on me.
And to Jamie and Lucy, If you ever see this, I just want you to know that I love you so much. And through doing this, we're gonna get back. We're gonna have a really happy future together.